Hi, I'm Adrian Hernandez, the chair of QCOR 2019. And today I'm with Bob Harrington, who's the chair of medicine for Stanford and also the president-elect of the American Heart Association. We just finished a great session on real-world data into real-world evidence and what that means for the future. One of the key questions that we're trying to understand is, right now, we are often acting on evidence from clinical trials, which only represents about 2% of people that we see every day, yet we have to make decisions on the other 98%. And every day, we are accumulating data through electronic health data, health systems, and other means actually outside of the healthcare system to be able to answer questions using that data, but there are a lot of challenges around that. So Bob, like, what were the kind of key issues that came up? It was a lively discussion, to say the least.
It was a very lively discussion. We went way over, as you know, because there were so many questions, and I think that reflects people's interest in the topic, which is terrific. And I think, Adrian, you framed it well, which is that for the vast majority of the decision-making we have in clinical medicine, whether it regards diagnostic, interventions, therapeutics, we're left with an insufficient evidence base. And historically, we like to think that the information provided from a randomized clinical trial about an intervention is the most reliable form of evidence. Well, that's the vast minority of the time. So then the question becomes, as you've nicely set up, how do we take all of this evidence, all this data that's available, analyze it in a way that then becomes usable for the end user, which is the patient and their clinician? And that was the basic tenet of the discussion.
There was this tension, it seems like, in terms of the issues that come up in terms of trying to understand the effectiveness or efficacy around drugs versus devices. And the life cycles are different in terms of the science and development of either drugs or devices.
Yeah, I thought that was one of the more interesting twists in the discussion, is that the life cycle today of a medical device is, you know, months to maybe many months. The life cycle of a drug may be decades. And so how one accumulates evidence rapidly obviously is going to differ for those two indications. I mean, you and I are practicing cardiologists. We're using things like statins on an evidence base that's accumulated over 30 years. We're not using any devices where the evidence base is accumulating over 30 years. We're using it, you know, these things are really undergoing rapid iteration. And so we have to figure out what kind of evidence can we glean from real-world data, electronic health records, wearables, sensors, et cetera, where we can make decisions in more real time.
And Bob, one of the things that came up, it sounds like you were arguing that, like, actually our studies should take advantage of real-world data and insert randomization, and not necessarily do smaller studies, do larger studies.
Yeah, I think that for common medical conditions that affect a lot of people, which is most of what, you know, you and I deal with, we need studies to be exponentially larger. And we need studies to be exponentially larger because much of what we're looking for are modest treatment effects, and so you need large sample sizes. We need them to be larger because we're trying to get at subsets that may have been underrepresented in your 2%. And so I do think that they need to be exponentially larger. But they can't be the kind of clinical trials that we're currently doing.
Mm-hmm. And what the Apple Heart study, that's a great example of the possibilities here. What was
Yeah, so the Apple Heart study was is a great example of the possibility, remembering that it wasn't a trial. Mm-hmm. It's an observational study run by Mintu Turakhia, Marco Perez, Ken Mahaffey, in collaboration with Apple to try to understand, can your watch detect atrial fibrillation in an asymptomatic or previously not reported AFib population? What was exciting to me is that they were able to recruit over 400,000 subjects in 8 months.
Wow.
That's extraordinary. I mean, yeah. You and I have been involved with trials where it takes you 10 years to right. do 15, 20,000 patients. So now, then the question becomes, and you know, John Spertus brought this up during the Q&A, well, that's all well and good for people who are just giving you information observationally, but what about when you want to randomize them? And I think John makes a good point. I don't think the answer is there yet, but the possibility is there, that you can recruit vast numbers of patients very quickly then the question is, can we impose randomization on that and still get quality data?
Right. And now imagine, you know, the next few years. How do you see this evolving? I mean, the intensity of the discussions around, hey, we just have this data, let's just use it now to address the questions versus, you know, maybe can we get a better answer?
Perfectly framed is that in the absence of a better answer, I think that the conversation we had in our session was around how do we ensure that the analytical methods are appropriate, that the reproducibility methods are appropriate, that the reporting methods are appropriate. And if that's the best we have, let's use it. It's better than people trying to remember their last 10 cases, of which they only remember the good ones.
Right.
And so let's use what we have done in the most appropriate manner. But let's not say, oh, we're done. Because for many things, again, if you want to compare A versus B, you can do all the adjustment you want. They're still confounding.
Right.
And we still have to randomize if we want the most reliable estimate. So my push has been, well, let's figure out how do we impose randomization on real-world data.
Right. And last question, related to your talk last night where you highlighted that there has been progress in cardiovascular health, but the last few years, we've lost some ground, and that's real-world data.
Yeah.
So how do we bring these two worlds together to change that?
Well, a comment that came up again in our session today was around the health disparities, health equity issues. And certainly from the Heart Association perspective, we very much are looking at health data through an equity lens. And one of the challenges that you see in the progress that we're making in heart disease is it's not been equitably distributed. Mm-hmm. That there are populations who are not getting the benefit. And so we continue to see over the years a decline in death from heart and stroke diseases, but that decline's beginning to flatten. And it's beginning to flatten in large part because of inequitable distribution of health benefits, whether that's relatively straightforward things like Life Simple 7 and attention to diet and exercise and tobacco cessation and blood pressure control, or if it's more than that, including medications for treating things like diabetes. I think all of that's at play right now. And so, yes, progress is being made, but if we're going to really end the scourge of heart disease and stroke, we have to be attentive to everybody, not just the 2% as you've indicated.
Right. And that seems like at the end of the session, a call to action that we got to go faster. We got to get better evidence, including the strategies of care, medical technology that includes devices or drugs to improve cardiovascular health.
Yeah, I mean, I borrowed a slide from my colleague Mintu Turakia. 77% of us in the United States use a smartphone. That's extraordinary.
Right.
And that is a device that people are utilizing. It can measure your steps, it can measure your movement, it can give you a way to report your patient-reported outcomes. There's a lot of things we can do. Now, there's still the 23% that don't have one that right. We have to figure out how do we reach them as well. But starting with 77%, better than starting with 2%.
That's great. Well, Bob, thanks for spending time here with us at QCOR, and look forward to a great year with you as president of AHA and bringing outcome science and research to our best to achieve the AHA goals.
Well, congratulations on a great meeting. I've been delighted to be here, and I look forward to working with QCOR over the next year as we try to move the ball down the field.